Greetings, YouTubers. Here is the guy with the Swiss accent, with a new episode around sensors and microcontrollers. Last year, we worked with the deep sleep function of the ESP8266. In video number 147, I started to look into the new ESP32. And of course, we are interested if and how the deep sleep works, especially because the ESP32 has a so-called ultra-low power coprocessor. This fact promises new possibilities. So let's dig into the matter to find out if we can deep sleep the ESP32, if we are able to wake it up, and what kind of possibilities we have to trigger the wake up. But first, let's get an overview. The ESP32 chip has two processors, the main and the ultra-low power or ULP processor. And it has plenty of pins which can be used by these two processors. As we saw in video number 147, most of the ESP32 pins have many different functions, which can be quite confusing if you look at the datasheet. This is why I tried to sort them and put them in an Excel sheet. But I did not use the pins of the ESP32 chip itself for this chart. I used a pinout of the WeRoom32 module, which we find on most of our development boards. Using this sheet, you can sort the pins along different lines. If you are, for example, interested in the GPIOs, you sort it according the GPIOs, or according the ADC pins if you are interested in ADC pins. You find a link to this sheet below in the comment. Some pins can also be used by the ULP processor. They are called RTC GPIOs. Let's sort our table along these pins. We discover 17 pins. RTC GPIO 1 and 2 are not available on the WeRoom 32 module. Next, we look at the touch pins. We find 10 touch sensors. And they are also connected to the ULP area. These pins will be used later on. Now let's move on to the power modes of the ESP32. It supports 5 different modes, from active, where everything is on, to hibernation, where everything is off. Today we concentrate on 2 modes, active and deep sleep. And we see that even during deep sleep, the ULP processor can be kept on. Cool. But how much current does the module consume in this state? According to the datasheet, it is 0.15 milliampere or 150 microampere. But how can we wake the ESP32 up from his deep sleep? With the ESP8266, we basically had 2 possibilities. Either reset the chip from an external source or connect GPIO 16 to the reset pin for a timed wake up. And with the timer, we were only able to sleep for about 1 hour. The ESP32 has 4 different wake up sources. The timer, 2 possibilities of external wake ups, the touchpads, and the ULP coprocessor wake up. Today we will only cover the 3 first possibilities because I do not know how to program the ULP processor with the Arduino IDE. The timer wake up is similar to the same mode in the ESP8266. We define how long the ESP32 should sleep, and next we start the sleep mode. In the definition statement, we define the time to sleep in microseconds, not in milliseconds as with the ESP8266. And the format of this number is uint64_t, which means that we could define a sleep duration of 584,000 years, not only 1 hour as with the ESP8266. And the second important difference is that we do not need an external connection between GPIO 16 and the reset pin as with our ESP8266. It works just out of the box. Next, we start the deep sleep. Now the ESP32 as the ESP8266 sleeps and, when the wake-up call comes, starts with the execution of the setup part of our sketch. Our sketch never reaches the loop statement, and we have to write our programs completely different if we use deep sleep than a normal sketch. Here we see another difference to the ESP8266. We get good information on the boot procedure. For example, we see that the reset was caused by deep sleep, and the wake-up was caused by the timer. And we will see that we even get more information later on. You might have overseen another very cool new feature. We can use the RTC memory without a library. We just prefix the variable definition with RTC_data_ATTR. And we do not lose data during deep sleep. Normal variables are lost because, as I said, our sketch starts each time with setup. This was much more complicated with the ESP8266, and it was even worth a whole video, video number 60. The ESP32 has 8 kilobyte SRAM in the RTC part, which is called RTC fast memory. It survives deep sleep, but not the pressing of the reset button, as we see here. The number of boots counts up till I press the reset button, then it is set to zero. The first wake-up source had already many advantages over the ESP8266. Will this continue with the other sources? The next one is wake up by an external source. This was also possible with the ESP8266 by resetting the chip. Here we get much more possibilities. We can wake up the chip by one particular pin only. Let's assume we have our IFTTT dash button from video number 108, where we have just one button and we want to wake our ESP32 by pressing this button. To achieve this, we have to select the EXT0 mode and tell the chip which pin is connected to the button. And in addition, we can decide if we want to trigger the wake-up by a low or a high state of the pin. To find out the pin number is a little tricky. We have to use the GPIO number of the pin itself, not the RTC GPIO pin number. Fortunately, we still have our Excel sheet and we can see that RTC GPIO0 and GPIO 36 are connected to the same pin on the VROM 32 module. But on our Lollin board, we do not find a GPIO 36 pin. Did they forget it? Fortunately not, but it has a different name on the silk screen. It is called VP. The secret behind this is here. Another function of this pin is also sensor_VP. By the way, the same applies for pin GPIO3, which is named VN. One other thing is important. I had, depending on the interrupt polarity, to connect an external pull-up or pull-down resistor to the pin. I used a 100 kilo ohm resistor and it worked. But what if we would like to have several buttons on our IFTTT device? Also here, our new toy offers an elegant solution. We just use the EXT1 wake-up source. In this mode, we can use several pins for wake-up. Because we can declare more than one pin, we have to define a so-called mask instead of only one pin. The easiest way to understand this mask is to write it in binary format. A lot of zeros and a 1 for each GPIO you want to enable as a wake-up source. The numbering again is based on the normal GPIO numbering. To my knowledge, 8 pins from GPIO 32 to GPIO 39 can be used. But GPIOs 37 and 38 are not available on the VROOM 32 module. So we still have 6 pins left. Because the first pin available is GPIO 32, the mask contains 32 times 0 on the right. Then for each enabled pin, we write a 1. If we do not want to use a particular GPIO for wake up, you have to write a 0 at this place. And in hexadecimal, this number is like that. The definition call for this mode is like that. After wake up, you see the source of the wake up and you can check which pin was used. The corresponding call is like that. Pay attention, the return value is a 64-bit integer and cannot be printed directly in the Arduino IDE. You have to cast it into a 32-bit integer for printing. The results are shown here. And with this information, your ESP32 can decide if you press the button to order toilet paper or a bottle of wine. So far, we covered 2 of the 3 wake-up sources. The last one is the touch wake-up. Also, this wake-up works somehow similar. The deep sleep is started with the same command, and after deep sleep, the ESP32 also starts with the execution of setup. The definition of the touch pin, however, is different. This source uses touch interrupts, and you attach the interrupt of each touch sensor you want to use to a callback function. If you do not attach the interrupt, the sensor is inactive. In addition, you have to enable touchpad wake-ups. Now you can use the touch sensors of my last video to wake up the ESP with a touch of a finger. Cool. Summarized, we were able to deep sleep the ESP32 to save lots of power for our battery operated devices. We were able to use 3 out of 4 sources for wake up. The timer, 2 possibilities of external wake ups, and the touchpads. We looked at the datasheet and saw that the deep sleep current should be around 150 microampere. We discovered that not all ESP32 pins are available on the VROOM 32 module, and some are named strangely. By chance, we discovered how simple it is to use RTC memory, which survives deep sleep. And we discovered that we can deep sleep the ESP32 for years, not only for an hour like the ESP8266. In a later video, we will then measure the real current used by the VROM 32 module, including the flash chip and all the other parts. I hope this video was useful or at least interesting for you. If true, then like. Bye.